welcome to this edition of Steelfist.
This one, we're just hanging out
in the backyard.
That's right.
Yeah.
Fixing to watch some fights. What are you doing?
I'm gonna watch some fights.
That's what I'm saying. Let's get on with some fights.
Just the matchup here, though. I mean, what are we seeing here? They both have similar records right now.
Yes, they're both 0-1, both trying to get their first win in the cage. You know, I'm actually interested in who does get that first win.
Yeah, you know, and they're going to be drinking hard tonight. My guess. I don't know. I do drink. Alysa Carroll is in the red corner wearing the black shirt with the gray trunks. And then you've got Alysa, the Tigress Westergard, sitting in the black corner wearing the blue trunks with the white top. All right, so Tyler Tomlinson bringing them out. Nice.
Alysa kind of went for the glove touch, and wasn't having it.
Didn't look like Alysa wanted to do the touch of the gloves there. Now, that's not necessarily a disrespectful thing. I know a lot of gyms, the coaches say, no, you touch gloves at the beginning of the fight when the referee brings you together, and you can give each other a hug at the end.
Now, there's been multiple fights where they do the glove touch, and they get an overhand right to the chin and knocks them right out of the fight.
Yeah, it can be dangerous for you. And I've been, so far, this is why I love women's MMA, because these ladies are going at it. Neither one of them is actually backing away and avoiding action. They're both moving forward very heavily. Earlier up until Alysa was able to get this over-under with the headlock in here, it was going back and forth with the striking. Like they were pushing each other against the cage. What are we seeing right now?
No, they both were swinging for the fences. That's what, like you said, I love the women fights because that's what they do. They know how, they love to fight. They just swing and they try to knock each other's heads off.
You know, generally, you're going to see a much more intense fight out of the females than you do out of the males. And it's surprising for some people, but not for me because I've been seeing it for so long.
Well, also, have you ever had a feud with a guy compared to a girl? They hold it a lot stronger than the guys do.
It's true. It's very true. Alysa doing a really good job pushing Alysa against the cage and landing a good flurry there. And Alysa did a great job of closing the distance. So what are you seeing between the two of them? Are you seeing either one of them really having much of an advantage here?
No, they're kind of just in like a 50-50. You know, Alyssa's got that front headlock now, but... You know, maybe she gets that foot in front of him, she might be able to get that little head toss.
Maybe get the trip in. Yeah, if she can kind of change her angle just a little bit,
exactly.
Turn it into the trip. She does have the head very secure. I don't think that Lisa's going to get out of it
unless
Alysa lets go. So what I'm really liking that I'm seeing is they really do seem very evenly matched. Not just do they have identical records, but they are very evenly matched. I'm not seeing either one of them really have too much of an advantage in this fight.
No, with that... You know, that little headlock that she had, Alysa looked like she maybe weared out her arms a little bit. She came out a little bit tired after the separation.
Yes, and that's, you know, that's going to happen, especially with the amateurs. They tend to hold on to stuff a little bit too long instead of turning in, and maybe she should have gone for the underhooks and started turning against the cage to relax the biceps. Ooh, beautiful overhand right by Alysa.
Yeah, she timed that. She's waiting for Alysa to walk in. And again, keep that jab.
And you can tell it landed with some power behind it because Alysa turned her head completely away and started moving towards the cage, kind of like the stop hitting me move. That's why I like to call it. And looks like a, would you call that a failed takedown by Alysa? Or would you call that a takedown from Alysa?
Now it's a takedown.
You know what? Good job, Alysa. But I think that was more that Alysa wasn't able to actually complete the takedown and tripped forward. Alysa is in a better position right now, but I think she's gassed. Like you said, from that headlock, it looks like she is really gassed right now at the end of this first round.
Yeah, she's not even getting up into her corner. She's definitely tired.
Yeah, and you know what? Alysa got, you know, she failed on that takedown, ended up on the bottom, but in that exchange there when they were actually on the ground, I saw more action from Alysa throwing punches upwards towards Alysa than I did Alysa throwing punches or even trying to maintain a dominant position.
And she was able to actually do the kind of up kick to the body, push her off, and...
Which, again, with it being an amateur fight, you know, a lot of people think, oh, I'm on the ground, I'm going to up kick. You have to be really careful with an up kick because if it lands to the face, you're breaking rules as far as amateurs go.
Disqualified or a point taken.
Yep, eat very easily, and then that gives 5 minutes, up to 5 minutes for an illegal blow. And same thing, even in the professional side, if your opponent has a knee down, and you up kick to the face, that's an illegal strike because you can't kick to the face of a downed opponent.
Exactly.
So if you're the judge,
he's not. I don't think Alyssa's coming out.
Is she shaking off? Oh man.
Yeah.
You know, I hate to see that happen because that was such an entertaining first round of fight. But you know,
I was excited for a second round.
I really was. I agree completely.
And your winner, before we can start the second round, fighter refused to come out of her corner. It goes to the black, the red corner, Alysa Carroll.
Shoes and out the door. 5, I'm alive. 6, 7, 8, feeling great. 9, gonna shine, life is good. I'm doing fine. 10, gonna do it right and do it again, yeah. I look into the sky with all the beautiful color, but there's more than just for me, so gonna share it with another. I got to show, to give, let out. I want to sing and shout, take a look and see a beautiful morning that turns into a beautiful evening, and together make a beautiful life. And if you wanna see, then come along with me, that's right. And if you want a good tomorrow, it's pretty simple, got a final act to follow. And if you do, you have a future real bright. And it's a combination of consistency. Come on and say, oh, 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 oh.
If you're starting a new business and looking for the best credit card processing rates, look no further. TMC Solution has the best rates in the industry. We have free equipment, no long-term commitment, no lease.
Already have a merchant account for your business? We guarantee we can save you money. We are so confident in this, we'll even pay you $100 if we can't save you money on your most recent statement.
When it comes to saving your business money, we don't offer ideas, we offer solutions. Get started today by giving us a call or visiting our website.
Fitness and be the best that you can be. SBG Fitness in Spanish Fork.
Pat, Saturday, October 3rd, Legacy Event Center, all ages event.
That's right, up to 15 MMA bouts.
Yeah, we're gonna have a great mix of fights on there. Make sure you get to stillfistfight.com, get your tickets early. Remember, general admission's all seating in that venue. It's a great event for the family, so we hope to see you there.
We got another amateur bout scheduled for 3 3-minute rounds. Fighting out of the red corner, standing 5 feet 10 inches tall, weighing in at 145 pounds, with an amateur record of 6-3-0, doing it for Lovato's MMA, let's hear it for AJ Garcia!
Ladies and gentlemen, we have AJ Garcia making his way out to the cage right now. This man is 28 years old, standing 5 foot 10 inches tall, weighing in at 145 pounds with an amateur record of 7-3. What do we know about this guy, Steve?
You know, he's currently he's over there training at the garage, over there with Dave Castillo, Anthony Lovato, Lucas Montoya, some tough group of guys, Brock Williams. Those guys, they keep their fighters ready. The garage, that's cool, tough guys. He's probably getting beat up on all every day, so when he gets in that cage, he's ready.
Yes, he definitely is, and he's also, he's a freestyle fighter, what he says, but he's also a blue belt in Walt Bayless Combat Jiu-Jitsu under Anthony Lovato. His last opponent, he is coming off a very big win against Michael Lasky. I don't know if you're too familiar with him at home. Mike Lasky used to be a Power Ranger on TV. He's pretty good in the fight game. He's a very good Muay Thai fighter. AJ put on an absolute clinic with him as far as not just stand up, takedown, stand up, on the ground dominant positions. He looked very solid, and he's coming in here tonight to continue his streak. Why does he fight?
Well, the reason he fights, because that's what he's always dreamed to do. That's what he wants to make a name for himself, and fighting is the way he wants to do it.
You know what? It's true. He got into MMA because he had always been a fan of fighting and always been an athletic and extremely competitive individual. And he's coming up now on 3 years off of heroin, and he kind of gives that to MMA, helping keep him in the right path and right state of mind. And he says that MMA has definitely saved his life.
Now coming to the cage, Rowdy Akers, 40 years old, 145. Now entering the cage, Rowdy Akers, 40 years old. He weighed in at 145 and is 5'10". You know, he has a pro record, or amateur record of 5'3-1. What do you know about Rowdy?
I know that Rowdy is an old man living on a dream. No, I'm just kidding. Oh, Rowdy Akers is 40 years old. That was not a misprint or anything else. This guy, you would not be able to tell he was 40 if you met him in real life or even when you watch him in the cage tonight. He is in phenomenal shape. He trains out at one hit with Aldo Oriega and all the guys up there. I know that he's been fighting for a long time. How long? How long has he been fighting? If you can see that there, and what got him into fighting?
You know, the reason why he started fighting is being Rowdy. You know, he was chasing dreams. You know, that's what he wanted to do. He loves to fight. And, you know, that dream never ends. You know, I don't care if you're 18 years old like some of these guys or 40 years old. You always have that will of fight in you.
It's very true. And he says his fighting style is in your face. And that's definitely true. If you've ever seen this man fight, he's a very forward-moving fighter. He likes to bring the action. I don't know if Rowdy, if his parents knew calling him Rowdy, that he was actually going to be Rowdy. But this guy moves forward all the time and is constantly trying to either knock you out, take you down, or one or the other. He's not a back-away type fighter. What do we know about his day job?
You know, he does windows. He premieres windows. I don't know what that is.
You know, he works for Premier Windows. He works with windows and stuff like that. What about who's he dedicating this fight to?
He's going to dedicate this fight to Charlie Andrews. Charlie, you will see him later tonight. His mom passed away the other day. He's still stepping in the cage, going through a tragic thing, like someone's, your mom dying. I cannot imagine if my mom died.
And then getting in the cage right after that and
exactly.
Having a fight.
So Charlie, he's still in here. So he's going to dedicate that fight to Charlie because just so much heart that Charlie has, and that's what he says. He looks up to Charlie, how much heart Charlie has. The fact that he's able to step in the cage after such a tragic event happening and still be in here.
And what he says as far as fighting for Steelfist, he says it's an honor to fight and to be around and to stand shoulder to shoulder with a bunch of stand-up guys like Steelfist Fight Night, like Kevin Patton, like Pat Patton, like Troy Spears. He says it's definitely an honor to be here. Message that he has for his opponent, AJ Garcia, let's go. He's ready to get this thing started.
Stepping in the cage, you know, it looked like Rowdy had a lot of respect for AJ. I'm not much of a Facebook guy.
Right.
I logged on Facebook. I saw AJ when he was signing the contract for this fight. He says he's never disliked someone so much in his life. That's what made me a little shocked to see him actually touch gloves and be respectful. I don't know what something happened. But the fact that I even saw him say that about his opponent, he's never disliked anyone so much in his life.
You know, and you see the pacing going on by AJ. A lot of people pace before a fight. It's a mindset thing. It helps you get in the game. But he's pacing and staring down Rowdy Akers. I think he just wants to punch the guy in the face, win or lose. I think he just wants to hit him as hard as he can. Ethan Andrews, our referee, bringing them about to give some last-minute instructions.
Now he's just letting him go.
All right, have you seen AJ fight before?
I have. Actually, I was there when he was putting on that clinic. He did have a complete MMA game. He kept it standing. He was dominating there. Then he took it to the ground. Then he was able to just control everywhere that fight went. And you know, he's planning to do the same thing this fight.
And that was a beautiful takedown coming in off of a loose punch from Rowdy Akers. He was able to secure the legs and drive forward and just dump him to the side when he got against the cage. What are you seeing Rowdy doing right now?
You know, he immediately went for that arm and guillotine, which I'm not a fan of, but he was able to get them tossed over. AJ used the cage to kind of get over the side control, which is awesome cage experience. That's what he gets with 10 amateur fights.
Yeah, you get that with amateur fights, but you see stuff like that at the pro level too. The ability to kind of roll over from that kind of a position into a crossbody. But that comes more from, the jiu-jitsu training.
Well, it's also knowing cage experience. You know where the cage at. When he was flipping over, he could have went to his back, but he saw the cage, used it to his advantage, and was able to end up in side control.
And doing a great job of securing a full mount position right now. Rowdy did a great job of seeing it and getting that arm under the knee and kind of forcing him to turn. Rowdy needs to be careful, though. I keep seeing him grab the shorts.
Yeah.
And is that legal?
It's not legal. You cannot grab the shorts, which is, you know, still not good because he's able to get into mount anyways.
Yeah, you know, AJ's doing a great job of developing position here. And if you can hear the crowd out there at home, if you can hear the crowd out here, they are going nuts. Half of this crowd is yelling Rowdy. The other half is yelling AJ. AJ is able to turn into a very nice armbar. Rowdy's doing a good job defending it. But AJ.
Right to the triangle. He gave up that position, and AJ was able to go. He's kind of turning the wrong way.
Well,
but
at this point, I don't think it really matters to him.
No, it's tight.
It's tight, and as long as he keeps pulling down and hipping up, he might have this fight secure right now. But beautiful transition.
It was. He was going to that armbar. I was actually going to say I wasn't a fan of him going for that armbar, being in that position, but it actually worked out to his back, and now he's going to the right leg.
Going to the right leg. Now, one of the things that AJ is going to need to do, and that I'm seeing Rowdy do really well to defend it, he's going to need to drag that arm across the face. Right now, Rowdy's kind of keeping that arm straight and keeping it to the outside of AJ's body, which is going to make it a lot harder to finish it. Well, what do you think he's going to need to do?
What AJ should do is actually kind of extend that arm. Even though he has the triangle position, he should extend that arm and get that arm bar.
The very sneaky escape right now from Rowdy just exploding out as soon as he let up even a little bit.
And, you know, that might have worn out AJ's legs. You know, holding on to that triangle, it takes a lot out of you. Even though you're being choked, you're taking a lot out of your legs. And
we refer to it as spaghetti legging, you know, when you hold someone in a triangle for the entire round or even a portion of the round. It's pretty dangerous, but AJ is just really dominating the positions here. But again, Rowdy is so energetic, I guess is
he
the best word.
A lot of heart.
A lot of heart. And you know, being 40 years old, I'm out of gas watching it. But being 40 years old, he's got a lot of energy to be able to keep going in this fight so far.
Yeah.
Going in before I would have switched it to the triangle.
Well, I was more not happy with him giving up now for that armbar so early in the round. I mean, you have plenty of time. Don't give up position yet. Control the punches. You might be dominating right there. But he went for this mission. He was able to get close. And he looks still fresh. He doesn't look like he has those spaghetti legs we talked about.
Oh, no. He did exactly what he did in the first round. And as soon as there was a light jab thrown, he went under and closed the distance and was able to secure that nice takedown.
Now Rowdy has a nice single leg. It's deep, but...
You know what? That goes to what I was talking about earlier on the energy and explosiveness that Rowdy has. He was able to power through and explode out of that down position and grab the leg and start going for his own takedown.
And now he has his own guillotine.
He's definitely in a position where he can take it away from AJ. But
set up the scrambles.
This fight is what you want to see at a live show because these guys are going back and forth and they're not giving up any momentum. At least as far as attempting momentum right now.
No, if you look around, not a lot of people are actually sitting down right now. There's a lot of people standing up.
The crowd is going nuts. Just like the first round, you've got it torn. Half of the crowd yelling Rowdy, half the crowd yelling AJ. And now AJ in that mounted position, dropping hammer fists.
You know, maybe he maintains that mount position instead of giving up position and maybe has the ref step in instead of...
Yeah, you know, Rowdy turning to the side like that. Ethan's going to be looking to stop. Oh, never mind, Rowdy.
Throwing the punches.
You know, if a ref doesn't stop it, don't stay on your side.
No.
Because you're just going to keep getting hit for no reason. I love that Rowdy doesn't care about getting punched in the face right now.
Rowdy's a tough, tough kid. That's for sure. Not even a kid, man.
Man.
He's a man.
He's a tough old man. And, you know, the only thing I'm seeing Rowdy do wrong right there, I would have loved to see him do exactly what he did, but trap the leg with his right leg, trap the left leg of AJ Garcia as he did that turning. He would have been able to dump and reverse that mount.
Now, AJ looks a little high if Rowdy would get his butt up in the air and kind of tripod.
He does look high, and he only has one hook really set, and it's not really set that, you know, that deep because it's at that angle. What do you want to see from Rowdy? He's in a dangerous position right now. I know maybe controlling the arm, or do you want to see him?
I want him to get his hips out like he just did. AJ was able to get mount because Rowdy didn't raise his hip a little bit. He raised his hips a little bit higher than AJ did.
Right. Was able to start turning and change it so that AJ didn't have complete back-to-back contact.
No, it'd make it a little bit more of a scramble, but Rowdy had his hips up in the air.
Yeah. So what I was talking about before as far as trapping the leg, you see how AJ's leg is getting lowered by the butt of Rowdy. If Rowdy would just bring his leg up really high and step over the foot and start going for a reversal that way, he might have been able to do something with it. But it looks like AJ might have this armbar on if he can bring his knees together.
He
lost it. Rowdy's,
man, he's tough. He's pushing through positions.
He is very explosive the way he just exploded in there.
That's a late punch. Ethan Andrew saved that.
AJ, I think AJ's winning this fight so far. Easily two rounds to none. But the amount of energy, the smile on both Rowdy's and, well, maybe that's not a smile on AJ's face, but the smile on Rowdy's face is definitely getting the crowd pumped up right now. If you were Rowdy's corner, what are you telling him to do coming out in this third round?
No, you need that finish. I don't care where you get it from the ground. He almost had a guillotine earlier. You know he's going to be pushing the pace. Just kind of sit down on your punches. Don't get taken down.
Oh.
Don't get hit like that.
That was a beautiful jumping uppercut is the best way I can say that. Just sneaking in and throwing it very...
AJ's tired. You know, Rowdy's pushing through it. And yep. He has a guillotine right here.
You know, and that's one thing that I don't want to see happen if I'm in AJ's corner. He needs to keep driving through and start turning to try and maybe come out the side and get a better position. What do you want to see Rowdy do right now?
I want Rowdy to slip that arm a little bit deeper and actually commit to that Gaethje. I think he had it. It was under the throat. It's not anymore, but if he would have committed to it, I think he could have got it.
I think that you're right, and I think that Rowdy's doing a great job of maintaining a dominant position and putting that forward coming at you fight style that he talks about on AJ right now, and he's definitely making it hard for AJ to do anything.
Yeah, AJ's tired.
AJ is very tired. And you know what? Even if he wasn't, the kind of pressure that Rowdy's putting on from this angle, it's going to take it out of you.
Oh, tough.
Tough loss on that position.
Yeah,
kind of
just fell over his own two feet.
Yeah, it looked like he was off balance going for those punches, and AJ was just able to kind of dump him, and it didn't really look like it was too much energy for AJ to get that dump. But do you think that AJ's got enough left in him to really be able to finish in this third round?
If I was AJ right here, I wouldn't try them out. You get that position up where you could kind of use that cage now, where if he was in side control, he could kind of keep him away from that cage where he can't push over.
And flatten him out a little bit more and keep him from being able to do much. Now Rowdy's able to use the cage and try coming out the back door or rolling upwards, right?
Yeah, just anything like that. And AJ's tired, so he might give up position. He's doing a great job right now of just maintaining position and holding on.
You know, honestly, I would not want to see Rowdy do that. Now he's got one leg through. He's in that half guard. I would like to see him turn to his right side and maybe start pushing the knee of AJ Garcia to get that full full guard position. But AJ, do you want to see him go for a submission and try and end this fight, or do you want him just to try and control for the rest of the round?
You know, if I was a coach, I would just want to maintain position, kind of coach. You know you're up two rounds. Go ahead and finish the round on top. Try to make it 3-0. But AJ's tough. AJ's not going to want to be happy with just a decision. He wants a finish.
Well, and I don't think that he's going to be against the decision. I don't think he's going to be happy with just laying there on top of someone. And he was doing a great job of controlling and maintaining that top position, forcing the shoulder down of Rowdy Akers. Yeah, that right arm's not going anywhere, and he's just continuously landing those little rabbit punches to the side of Rowdy's head.
And they don't look like a lot, but they do take a toll on you. He could hit him with the...
You know, and even if it doesn't hurt or take a toll on you, it's going to add points in the judge's eyes.
And you're not defending yourself. You know, Ethan could step in at any moment now.
And I don't think Ethan will, because there's less than 10 seconds left now, and it's not heavy enough punches to end the fight. But I think this is going to go to a decision, ladies and gentlemen.
Oh.
Late punch, but you know what? Heat of the moment, it happens. I don't think it was intentional. These guys, I don't care if AJ didn't like them. I'm sure he's got a lot more respect for Rowdy now.
No, that was a fun fight to watch. Back and forth action, toss and turvin. AJ won. You know, I think it's going to be...
Yeah, I think AJ won all three rounds.
I think he stole that round.
But I think that Rowdy almost took this third round away from him. Very, very easily. So I would hate to be a judge tonight, because you're going to piss somebody off.
You know, and the thing is, AJ did win the two rounds. The third round kind of...
Yeah, the third round could have been either way. I think he did enough in the last half to take the round back. But Rowdy, now obviously I'm not a judge. I can't predict the future. But if I had to guess, I'd say Rowdy, you just pulled off a loss. Don't hang your head about it. You looked really good tonight. But AJ just happened to look a little bit better.
Yeah, I don't care if you're 18 or 40, man. That guy does not stop moving.
No, that dude is tough. Let's take it to the cage for the official announcement.
Going to the referees, and by unanimous decision, your winner out of the red corner, AJ Garcia!
Ladies and gentlemen,
Pat, where are you going to be Saturday, October 3rd?
I'm going to be where everyone should be. I'm going to be at Steelfist Fight Night.
That's right. That event's coming up. We hope to see you there.
Steelfist Fighting!